Hello and welcome to this episode of Simple Truth Sabbath School. We are on lesson number 9 of the second quarter of 2024. Time seems to be flying, doesn't it?
Indeed.
Especially yes. When we're all really, really busy and we all have a lot of stuff going on. But the title of the lesson is one that it's a deep, deep subject. So. Word of warning, I don't know how far exactly we're going to get, but hopefully how far we do get does justice to the foundation of God's government. And as we're going to see, it's a discussion on the law of God and how it applies to us. And if we're not careful with this subject of the law, we could misrepresent God in a way that he never ever intended mm-hmm. with the law and toward the law. Mm-hmm. And so joining me today to my immediate right is Jo Engelhorn, and she does master control of the
health channel.
Health channel mm-hmm. here at Better Life.
And sometimes I'm here at
yep.
this table.
Yep. And you share with us sometimes. We appreciate yeah. that. And Pastor Edward Nelson. He's the pastor of the Grants Pass Church right across the parking lot here.
Yes.
And we're glad you're here, and we're glad your contributions to the church too here. And so we need to anyway, but the depth of the subject, I think we need to ask the Spirit to come into the situation.
Absolutely. I'd be glad to. Dear Heavenly Father, we are thankful for the light that shines from your word. And without your Holy Spirit, Lord, we cannot discern or understand. So shine that light on us. Give us your Spirit. And help us to understand, Father, what these things mean for us today. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to come back to this this text, but I'm going to go ahead and read it. It's the memory text, but a lot there. Mm-hmm. And it's Revelation 12, verse 17. And it says, "And the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, who keep the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ." Just that verse alone, I think that we probably could spend quite a bit of time just really, really opening and catching all kinds of different angles on. But there's something that's really key to this. The foundation of how the dragon, representing Satan, looks at us is one of anger, and he wants to go to war. And let's face mm-hmm. it, when we go to war, we have casualties. Mm-hmm. And that's really what he desires of all of us, for us to be casualties of this war. Mm-hmm. And one thing that's really, really key is, based on the title, the foundation of God's government, God wants us to understand that the way that he rules is something that's supposed to be of a protectiveness as opposed to rage and hatred. Mm-hmm. And so anything that we do that would be something that Satan would bring to the table, we need to make certain that everything he aims in our direction is war, rage, hatred. Mm-hmm. And so when we play that sort of a game, that's his game. But God's saying, no, my government's completely different.
Correct.
Yeah. And so... If you look at the beginnings of our church, we use, and of course this whole quarter is on the great controversy, and we use the great controversy theme quite a bit. But if you look at our church history is one in which there's been a lot of intense disappointments, struggles, but all along the idea was to let Scripture become the foundation of who we are and what we are. Mm-hmm. But if you notice, our church or any church that's striving to be faithful to God, what is one of the main struggles for a lot of us day to day?
Keeping the law is a struggle, right? In the way people think they're supposed to. If you don't understand the righteousness of Christ, then it could become mm-hmm. yep. a problem.
Yeah, that is one big issue is understanding it.
Yeah.
And realizing how it is that God makes it fit into our situation. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's a good one. Mm-hmm. I would say that He doesn't want us to have an understanding of the Word of God to where we can, like Jesus did, meet Him in battle with the Word of God. Because if we don't understand the Word of God to have it become a sword, then He's like, oh, you guys are easy prey.
So I guess what you were getting at maybe is a struggle is staying in the Word daily.
Yeah, yeah.
And meeting Jesus there and getting to know Him and love Him and cherish Him and honor Him and glorify Him while in the Word.
Right. And then when we do that, the law takes on a perspective that's one of willingness, one of love, versus one of, boy, what might happen if I break His law? But that's not the point. He's trying to say, if you understand, and we use this term a lot, it's a transcript of His character.
Yes.
And which is absolute truth, because if, in fact, this is all the stuff that He stands for, and this is who He is at the very depth of His being, that's somebody I can definitely fall behind. And then the idea of worship, because He's God, He's not just a man, He's God. And so for us to then say, that's somebody who I would most definitely willingly give my worship to.
This whole lesson comes down to worship. Who you're going to worship.
Yeah, it does. Definitely. You know, one of the things you talked a little bit about Satan's wrath and his anger and that it's aimed at God's people and that God has a different way of doing things. One of the things, the motivation for obedience, either to God or to the world or Satan, you know, you see in the text we're going to study, you're going to see the dragon is willing to resort to deception and force. But on the contrast end of that, God does never resort to things like that. He always seeks to draw. He said, you know, Jesus said, if I am lifted up on the cross, that show of my Father's love and my love for humanity will draw all to me. And so Jesus invites and He draws us by His love. And that's one of the things that we'll see. There's a difference in the fundamental motive behind the government of God, which is seeking our very best, and the government of Satan, which is seeking his very best. And that difference is what the war is about.
So have you found that as you've been in the Word, as you've been in the Word, that the contrast between the two becomes greater and greater and greater? The forms of government or way of doing things. And so if, in fact, Satan had his way, he would have us be ignorant of the contrast.
Absolutely. He doesn't want God's light to be shining. He wants to keep everyone in darkness about the true character of God.
Yeah, because when the light shines, it tends to really change matters.
Yes, it does.
Well, and he started doing that in heaven itself with his fellow angels trying to destroy that character with lies so that God appeared to be selfish, to need to be, you know, adored in a selfish way and that kind of thing. I mean, to think it started right there.
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing.
So last week's lesson, we talked a lot about the sanctuary. Well, Sunday's lesson is entitled The Sanctuary and the Law. So we're gonna look into the connection between the two, and our prayer really is that we can do this subject the justice that because it is such a deep mine of thoughts. But so Joe, let's start off with Revelation 11:19, and then if you would jump over to Revelation 12:17.
Okay, yeah. So 11:19. Then the temple of God was opened in heaven, and the ark of his covenant was seen in his temple. And there were lightnings, noises, thunderings, and earthquake, and great hail. And then 12:17 is, and the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
And then let's do Exodus 25:16 and then jump over to Exodus 31:18.
Okay. Exodus 25:16 says, "And you shall put into the ark the testimony which I will give you." And Exodus 31:18, "And when he had made an end of speaking with him on Mount Sinai, he gave Moses two tablets of the testimony, tablets of stone written with the finger of God."
Boy, just if you written with the finger of God. Mm-hmm. So if somebody takes the time to etch it in stone, it's something that they deem pretty important.
Right. Well, and it's also, he wrote the words that he had spoken to everyone from the mountain, mm-hmm. which is why it's called the testimony. You know, so he spoke, he spoke the testimony to Israel, and then he wrote it in stone, and the ark was, it was placed in the ark. The ark was a symbol of the throne of God. The mercy seat itself was the, where the Shekinah was revealed in the presence of God, literally, you know, seated. But the title of this lesson, interestingly, is the foundation of God's government. And what was it that was underneath the seat of his government? It's the law of God, which mm-hmm. Jesus tells us is love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. That's right. The foundation. The foundation is love.
Yeah.
So I'm going to ask a question. So the testimony of Jesus sounds like, when you read those passages, that the testimony is the tablets of stone with the commandments on it. And yet, when it says, when it talks about those who keep the commandments and the testimony of Jesus, that sounds like two separate
things.
Correct. So is the testimony of Jesus referring to the tablets with the law, or is it speaking to the faith, us having the faith of Jesus?
So the testimony of Jesus, we don't have time to go into a full Bible study on it, but if you look in
Revelation 19:10,
which we normally go to, but there's another verse in Timothy, and I just want to make sure that it's the right verse.
Sorry, so second,
it's okay.
No, that's right.
2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, Paul says, you know, stir up the gift that is in you through the laying on of hands. Timothy had the gift of the Holy Spirit by the laying on of Paul's hands. This is confirmed in the next verse. He says, "For God hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and love and a sound mind." That's what the Holy Spirit brings. It brings soundness of mind. It brings love. The love of God is shed abroad in our hearts, according to Romans. And then the very next verse says, "Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord." The testimony of our Lord. The Lord is Jesus. Jesus is Lord. Mm-hmm. So the Holy Spirit is the one who speaks the words of Christ to the church today. And so when the Bible says, John says this right in the chapter 1. He says, "I was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God, and because of the testimony of Jesus." So I was on the island of Patmos because I was preaching what God had given us through his word, and I was speaking what the Holy Spirit was giving me to speak. Mm-hmm. So, and that's why Revelation 19:10 identifies the testimony of Jesus as the spirit of prophecy, because it's the Holy Spirit that inspired prophecy. Mm-hmm. So the testimony of Jesus is a title for the Spirit of Christ. It's okay. A title for the Holy Spirit. And he has different functions, but in a nutshell, I'm trying to be brief.
Well, I've always heard of it as the testimony of Jesus was the spirit of prophecy, but then during this lesson, I went, do I have a misunderstanding of what the testimony of, you know, of Jesus is? It seemed like it was more than the prophecy. I mean,
it's interesting. You have the... who is it that inspired every word in this book?
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And so the Holy Spirit does not speak of his own, Jesus tells mm-hmm. us. He brings us from the throne of God, the words of God. And the Holy Spirit speaks to us the words of Jesus Christ as well. And so when you say, it seems like the testimony of Jesus might be the law or the word of God, like those are not necessarily wrong. Mm-hmm. But in its greatest sense, it is everything the Holy Spirit has to share with us.
Okay. So something that's really, really key in what you read was it says that it was open. So it was wide open to be able to look into where mm-hmm. it is that the Ark mm-hmm. of the Covenant sat. And mm-hmm. what that's trying to say is that God is completely open. He's an open book to what it is that the foundation of his government is. Mm-hmm. So we when we hear the word law, it's like, oh, that's meant to limit us and all this stuff like that. God's saying it's wide open because and we won't turn there. But the law is described as the law, the perfect law of liberty. Mm-hmm. And where that is, there is liberty. And people say, well, how is it that law can be liberating? Mm. Only if God is the one who says, looking in, it's wide open to any form of scrutiny you want to give it, and it's mm-hmm. wide open to understanding. And the foundation of it is love and love.
It's also wide open to your choice of whether to follow it or not.
I mean, there's, it is.
You know, there's a choice there, which how can you be any more, patient, open-minded, yes. when you allow others to decide for themselves? Mm-hmm.
And so... In the lesson, it brings specifically the Day of Atonement. We covered it last lesson as well, but this lesson, it talks about the Day of Atonement. It says, well, this day was a day of judgment. And, of course, we don't like that word. We don't like law. We don't like judgment. We like grace. You know, I'm not under law, I'm under grace, and I'm not going to come under judgment because God's graceful. Well, it's only by his grace we could keep the law. That's key. Mm-hmm. But the idea of the Day of Atonement, what is it ultimately that people are looking for when they would look at the sanctuary service and us now? Our deepest desire is to know, at least this is the way I look at it, is to know that truly our sins have been covered. Mm-hmm. We have a place mm-hmm. that we could take our guilt, our shame. We have a place we could take all of that stuff. And we know that there's somebody who's faithful enough. And here's the other thing, too. Because of this idea of covenant, he's covenanted to take care of everything that's necessary to have us have absolute assurance that redemption and salvation is assured. Mm-hmm. And we're shown that Jesus is the way to understand that because we're told in Hebrews that he's our high priest. And it was the high priest, of course, and again, we don't have time to go into this a lot, but it was the high priest who one time a year was to go in and make atonement, and there was a whole ceremony of all that. He had to cleanse himself. But what Jesus is saying is, now I ever live to make intercession for you. So he's continuing to make his presence known to us so that we can have that continuation of assurance that through him we can keep the law, through him we can have redemption, through him we can be assured of salvation. Mm-hmm. And all of that is Day of Atonement type of language from back then. Mm. But for us today, are we still searching for the same thing that Israel was? We're still searching for the same assurance. Mm. And what really God is trying to do through all of this is to say that through me, you can absolutely have assurance of it, but you actually have to enter by way of my name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense.
Let me just read this just real quick. This is from the Great Controversy. Within the Holy of Holies in the sanctuary in heaven, the divine law is sacredly enshrined. The law that was spoken by God himself amid the thunders of Sinai and written with his own finger on the tables of stone. The law of God in the sanctuary in heaven is the great original of which mm-hmm. the precepts inscribed upon the tables of stone are recorded by Moses in the Pentateuch were an unerring transcript. Those who arrived at an understanding of this important point were thus led to see the sacred, unchanging character of the divine law. So it's it's the divine character. But here's the other thing that we're supposed to see, that all of this stuff here in terms of the sanctuary system from way back when was to point us to the perfect, which is in heaven. Mm-hmm. And so all of this sort of stuff is just to point us to the perfect.
Right.
And so it's, and if Satan could get us confused of us realizing that this here is supposed to be a shadow. But the thing is, if there's a shadow, then that there's actually a body mm-hmm. that light is passing through in order to mm-hmm. cast the shadow. And so if we could see the original, it would make us not confused as to the character of and the motives of God himself.
Yes.
So, and again, if the devil could, he would love for us not to have any light shining on us, and then we would completely misunderstand the motive of God himself.
Right.
And this is the motive. I mean, just think about it. I mean, if we just said, what if we just absolutely loved God supremely, and at the very center of it, one day a week, we were to focus in on Creator God, Redeemer God, and we focus in on Him. Is there anything wrong with that so far?
No.
And then when we get this type of understanding of God and relationship to God, then the next six are simply an expression of all of this understanding, and now this just comes naturally. And so to me, that's not stressful. That's something to where I say, Lord, you have made me see this stuff. Why would I want to misrepresent you or not have anything to do with you, and why would I mistreat you? And so to me, so far, that doesn't sound stressful. That sounds like something that's a natural manifestation of a relationship that God wants to be solid and intact. Nothing wrong with that so far.
So far, it's all good.
So let's go on to Monday's lesson, unless you have anything else to add. The immutability of God's law is Monday's lesson, and I nobody's going to know this person, so I think I can safely say this. But I had a conversation with when I was starting in a home health agency. Before I became a pastor, I did physical therapy, and I had a conversation with this nurse that was training me as to what they did out in the home health field. Mm-hmm. But she was a Christian lady, good Christian lady, and we started having this discussion. And she said, you Seventh-day Adventists, you still keep yourselves under law. Mm-hmm. And I said, I said, but it's only by grace we can keep the law. And so I said, I'm going to make a disclaimer. I'm going to make a very, very graphic statement for the sake of a point. And so she said, okay, what's that going to be? I said, well, you and I are in your car absolutely alone. The seventh commandment said we shouldn't commit adultery. Is your husband okay if in fact we had something happen between the two of us? And she's like, well, of course not. And I said, why not? Is it because it's wrong in your husband's eyes? Well, yeah. I said that I was committed to him, and he's committed to me, and I would never. And I said, it was for the sake of a point, okay? I'm married happily, okay? But the point is, according to just your human feelings, it would be wrong to do anything that was contrary to that vow you made to your husband, right? And I said, but it takes on a different light when I say, I just simply say, I don't want to displease God by committing adultery to you, which is the seventh commandment. And so, and I said, so by God's grace, you and I would never even have to deal with that. But yet, if we nailed that to the cross, anything goes, right? But the point is that if I make a covenant with somebody, mm-hmm. it's because I love them.
Right.
I don't feel that I'm missing out on something being committed to my wife. Right?
You right. Don't, no. Mm-mm.
You don't feel you're missing out on something. In fact, you actually have something that's expanding and growing because of that covenant, because of that commitment.
Correct.
And so at that point in time, what does it do? It's just simply a loving commitment that I'm just going to do because of our relationship to each other.
Right.
And it's not burdensome.
Right.
And as long as we live, it's immutable. It's not going away, my commitment to her. And so that's key to why it is that it has to be permanent, because the covenant itself is forever.
And that goes for every single commandment in the law.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
Every single one.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things, it's the motivation.
Yes.
The motivation as to why we keep the law, or why I'm faithful to my spouse or whatever. The motivation is key. Jesus said, if you love me, then keep my commandments.
Yeah.
He didn't say, you better love me, and if you don't love me, I'm threatening us. But once we love Jesus and fall in love with him, then keeping the commandments are not a burden.
Right.
And so it has to start with love, and it did start with love. When Jesus laid down his life for us, that's when 1 John tells us that's when we saw what love was, 1 John 3:16. But it also says, and now we love him because he first loved us. Mm-hmm. And so when we experience God's love, it grows love in our heart, and now we have the proper, because if we're just keeping the commandments out of fear or please don't, like, this is not pleasing to God. And it's a burdensome for us. Who wants to live in fear under a slave master? I mean, we don't want that.
Yeah.
And so, but like you said, when we walk in the law, it is liberty. But when we walk in sin, then we're slaves to bondage. And that's what God did not create us to be, slaves to bondage.
Right. So I'm not going to read the whole thing, but this is a quote from the reformer John Wesley.
I like that.
And I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm going to read just the last part because I think it's powerful. And interestingly enough, you know, the Wesley thought process is still somewhat alive and well today, but yet even it has morphed and changed from what Wesley thought about when he said this. And it says this: every part of this law must remain in force upon all mankind and in all ages, as not depending either on time or place or any other circumstances liable to change, but on the nature of God. So he's saying the nature of God doesn't change, and the nature of man and their unchangeable relation
to each
other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so he says in Scripture, I am the Lord your God, I change not. Mm-hmm. And he's not doing that to dig his heels in and be this stubborn God. He's just simply saying, I'm consistent.
Mm-hmm.
So for us as human beings, we try to say, well, that's rigid. No, that's consistency at its absolute key.
And that's trustworthiness. You cannot trust someone who is not consistent.
No.
I can't.
No.
Right, right.
You know?
And so with that level of uncertainty, if you had that level of uncertainty, how are you going to feel coming into that situation on a consistent basis?
Assured.
With God, but yet with a human being, if you don't have it, or you have the opposite, then mm-hmm. what are you going to have? If we go to the opposite extreme
mm-hmm.
of it,
mm-hmm.
insecurity,
fear,
anxiety.
Right.
Can I trust you?
Yeah. No, I know I can't trust you. So just like, because you've it's the whole Jekyll and Hyde thing. Sometimes you're nice to me. Sometimes you're like, mm-hmm. it's like, you know what? I'm done. I don't want that in my life.
Right.
That. How are you going to treat me today?
Yeah.
No.
So there's
interested.
There's a kid that moved in down the street from me, so we weren't really around each other very much. And then he comes one day and says, "Hey, you want to come and play?" And I said, "Yeah." And so we were playing, and I guess I wasn't playing the way he wanted me to. And he took, you know, the old Coke bottles.
Yeah,
so he took that Coke bottle and cracked that thing right over my head.
No.
And I was just like, you know, kind of like after I was like, whoa, felt like I was going to pass out. He cracked that thing over my head. And then, of course, obviously, I went home very soon thereafter. And then from that point forward, he's like, hey, how come we don't play anymore? Because you cracked me over the head with a Coke bottle.
Right? Oh, my God.
That's
goodness.
Why.
That's amazing.
So I mean, that's an extreme example. But yet he said, can we play? And then I was like, oh, okay, yeah, we're going to be friends. And then he cracked me over the head with a Coke bottle. Well, from that point forward, I had zero trust in
Absolutely.
Him. Absolutely. And it was like, and if he was ever to come into the situation, I was like, you know, I want people around that, number one, would make it so that I didn't grab a Coke bottle and crack him over the head back, or that he would try to hurt somebody else or me
right.
in the situation. And God's really trying to say to us, you know what, I'm going to give you this level of consistency. So to me, the law is something, if it's immutable, then I also get something that as a human being I desire, stability, predictability.
Everybody wants that
yeah.
and needs that.
Yeah, and that's not a bad thing.
No.
Right, right.
So let's read some scriptures on that. So Exodus 34, 5 through 7, I'll go ahead and read that. And then Joe, you'll end up with Psalm 119, those couple of verses. And then Edward, Matthew 5, 17 and 18. So, all right, verses 5 through 7 of Exodus 34. Now the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. But even that last little bit, if you take context, he's saying, the Lord, merciful and gracious. So, but he says he's visiting the iniquity, but the iniquity that any iniquity that I would have would be my choice. It's not what God is saying. Oh, you that's hidden. No, it's a choice that I've already made.
Mm-hmm.
So even in this, God being just, it says that he's his character, his name in Scripture was a very big deal.
Mm-hmm.
Name meant character,
mm-hmm.
or at least characteristics. And so, but then he says that this is who he is. Merciful, gracious, long-suffering, abounding in goodness, abounding in truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. But then he says, but I'm not going to clear the guilty. Why? Because the guilty actually made choice. Because the people who choose him, he honors. The people who don't choose him, he still honors. Because he's actually just simply honoring the ability to choose. People say, well, why didn't God come into that situation? Because he was honoring your choice. For somebody else put it this way, God is always a perfect divine gentleman. Always honoring that choice. So in this case, it's not that he says, okay, you didn't choose me, I'm going to wipe you out. What that means by visiting the iniquity of the fathers, that means that he's just simply allowing the natural freedom of man's choice to just simply manifest itself. And there's mm-hmm. a difference between God saying, in me is just a bunch of wrath. No, it says, in me is keeping choice intact even when it hurts me to my very depth of my being, when you don't choose me and the relationship that I've offered.
Well, in Revelation, I'm sorry, Exodus chapter 20, right in the heart of the Ten Commandments, uses the same language that this verse does. It says, visiting the iniquity of the fathers to the upon the children to the third and fourth generation. But it adds these words, of those who hate me.
Mm.
So when we make ourselves the enemies of God and we're fighting against God, this is what happens. But in the very next verse, it says, but showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments. God has made a promise to all those who love me and are keeping my commandments, I'm going to extend mercy to them. And so he invites us into love, but he says, if you hate me, those who hate me love death, he says in another passage of Scripture, because to hate the one who created you, to hate the one who is love, to hate the one who's trying to save you, means that he's already done everything he can do, and you have not responded to the offer. And
And yeah. But his posture is, I really wish you would.
Exactly. I have no desire that the wicked should perish.
Yeah.
Just like any parent with a wayward teenager or whatever, you know, that do everything in their power to help that child know they are loved and appreciated and wanted, and yet still so many walk away, you know, from their families. And finally just have to say, I did everything, but I will always love you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know.
So, Joe, would you read
142.
Yeah, 142 and 172.
Your righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and your law is truth. Well, who doesn't want a law that has truth in it? Mm-hmm. I mean, right?
So when Pilate said, what is truth? There it is.
God's words.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then 172. My tongue shall speak of your word, for all your commandments are righteousness.
So again, so I keep coming back to, if we were the devil, then we would try to convince people that his law is arbitrary, not righteous. Mm-hmm. 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 But yet, if we hear his words spoken by way of the Holy Spirit, inspiration there, it says that his law is righteousness. So, but if we decide to throw out the law, at that point in time, we're actually choosing to throw out his righteousness.
Right.
And I don't want to do that. Mm-mm. I don't want to do that at all. So, Pastor Edward, how about Matthew chapter 5?
All right, yeah, Matthew 5, 17 and 18. These are the words of Jesus. He says, do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, not one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled.
To make complete. It completes something, but it doesn't actually send it away, but it rounds it out. And he expressed it to the very furthest point possible when he fulfilled it. He expressed it. He didn't throw it away. And that's really, really key, is he became the embodiment of the expression. So the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So the Word of God was going to be fulfilled to the very depths that it possibly could be fulfilled in the personhood of Jesus.
Sure.
Yeah.
The other thing, you know, and we're not going to read this one, but it's in the lesson, Romans 7, 11 and 12. But the law itself is described as holy, just, and good. Mm-hmm. All of that, holy, just, and good. And so what we do then, when we uphold the law, it's not that we're being pharisaical. All we're simply saying is we want to represent God in a way that says he, through his law, is holy, just, and good. And so if we revert back to that, and so then what we're trying to do, if we call it a transcript of his character, then all we're trying to do is say we always want to make certain that we fall back to this position, and that is that his character is holy, just, and good. Thus, his law is the same.
And his character is unchangeable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so, therefore, his law is unchangeable as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Have you ever been around a person who is really inconsistent? I had this coworker years ago that I literally had no idea which version of this person was going to show up. And it was like, okay, because I would sort of start off like, okay, it's the happy version. Okay, good, we're okay. And then literally the next day, it would be the flipped on its ear and the sullen, sad, reactive version of the very same person. And it was difficult. It's like, which one?
The definition of what happens to you is walking on eggshells.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, moment
yeah.
by moment or day by day.
Yeah. But the thing is I believe God, knowing the very fabric that he knit us with, he says, I'm going to give you exactly what it is that makes you thrive. Mm-hmm. And all of this is knit into what we're talking about. I'm going to give you what you need to thrive. And that is stability. And there's nothing arbitrary about me. I'm going to give you that consistency and understand that everything I do is motivated by love, and that's the foundation of. And so in our human, I just remember my parents, I'm only doing this because I love you. And it's like, okay, yeah, whatever. But yet looking back, yes, they were. But as a kid, you're like, okay. Mm-hmm. But truly God says, I'm doing this because I love and respect you. Mm-hmm. And honor you, whichever direction you go, I still honor you.
And I'm not doing some things you ask because that would not honor you. That would not help mm-hmm. you to thrive, right?
Yeah.
So many people don't understand, or the image of God that's been presented to them is abhorrent. And there's a lot of religion, there's a lot of even pastors, parents who are religious, sometimes misrepresent God. And to those people that may be watching today, if you want to know what God is like, start reading in the book of Matthew. Because Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen my Father. Mm-hmm. Read the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and see how Jesus upholds the law of God as love to his Father, and then reaches for the sinner's hand and says, I don't condemn you. Go and sin no more. If you want to understand what is in the heart of God, read the gospel story, because the laws are given for our protection. I tell my daughter, don't run out in the street. I don't want her smashed by a truck and have no more life. I mean, that would be awful for me, but awful for her, And the things that I speak to my daughter are things that it would only be a benefit for her. And God speaks the same way to us, mm-hmm. yeah. So if we're confused on that, start reading in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. See how Jesus yeah. interacts with people. See the grace, and also see him uphold the law in the way that he lives in his own life. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I think that's important, because there's yeah. so many people that have had God misrepresented to them and don't understand.
Right.
And we start talking about his law, and they think it's arbitrary, unjust, all these other things.
So the other thing too, and this is a heavy weight, but whether we like it or not, people are looking to us as to who God is. And we're a poor representation of God, but yet it's like, Lord, help me to represent you as well as I possibly can.
Yes.
Unfortunately, earthly fathers, sometimes they paint a picture where it's like, if that's my heavenly Father, I want nothing to do with
yeah.
that. But yet, if in fact we allow his word to speak to us, it can also change how I process my earthly father. Mm-hmm. My earthly father was an imperfect human being who's capable of failing me, but my heavenly father is not.
Mm-hmm.
And when we do read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then we continue on into thoughts from Paul and so on and so forth, we start to see people who saw Jesus for who he was, and they said, let us tell you what we saw.
That's right.
And that's something that's really, really big. And I think what it does too, and going to that kind of segues to Tuesday's lesson, because specifically the Sabbath and the law. Mm-hmm. And as Seventh-day Adventists, we really uplift the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm.
And so the idea of what it is that the Sabbath is supposed to represent is something that's really key. And when we go to Revelation, I'm going to read Revelation 14, 6, and 7. When we go to Revelation, it says, then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water. Now, would I worship somebody truly if I didn't actually understand that their intention toward me mm. and their character toward me?
Maybe if you were fearful.
Right, but the thing is it would be forced worship. It would be coerced worship.
Sure.
But if I truly worship, I'm giving something as a gift. That's worship.
Mm-hmm.
Worship is not what I get. Now, I won't even go into that subject, because worship is not me coming in and saying, that worship service is boring. No, worship is what I give, mm. not what I get. But the key to this is big, because he's saying, give glory to him, and then you worship him as creator. If we worship him as creator, that's honoring the Sabbath. So this is something that is so key, because Exodus 20, it mentions Jesus as creator in terms of the basis of why it is that we keep his commandments. Mm-hmm. And Deuteronomy chapter 5, it's restated, and it actually says, but then he's mentioned as our redeemer.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So he's creator, he's redeemer, but as creator, he created us for a purpose. He created us for a relationship with him. And any other thought process is not representing him correctly. The Sabbath is so that we can worship him as creator. The very first Sabbath, or the very first full day on earth for Adam and Eve, was which day?
Well, it would have been Sabbath.
It would have been the Sabbath. Yeah. They knew nothing of their creator. They were perfect in their sphere at the time, but they knew nothing of their creator. Mm. So all of that very first full day on earth for them was just simply a day to walk with their creator and have him say, look at what I created for you. Look at what I created for you. So the idea of the very first Sabbath is something that's supposed to resonate through all of time. He's saying, look what, how I think of you. Look what it is that my heart toward you is, mm-hmm. and all of that. The idea of you can't.
Right.
No. There was no you can't in Genesis chapter 2. There was no you can't. It was, this is who I am to you. Let's walk together. Mm-hmm. And so the Sabbath, first and foremost, is meant for us to walk with him. But then, if you take the other six commandments, when we walk with him, we also, on Sabbath, want to walk with each other. The people who we have considered family in our churches. Mm-hmm. And so, and if we can look at it that way, now we represent God in a way to where it's not about all the stuff, it's about pause in relation mm-hmm. to me mm-hmm. and acknowledge me as a loving creator who wants nothing more than what's best for you. Mm-hmm. So let's do this. Speaking of Genesis chapter 2, Joe, would you share Genesis 2, 1 through 3? You shared part of Exodus 20, Edward, but maybe we can catch the first part of Exodus 20 when she's finished with...
Okay, Genesis 2. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. I mean, I think they said it three times. Yeah. He rested. Yeah. God rested.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So was it rest because he's like, man, I need a nap?
No.
So the key to this is, it says, he rested in his creation. Mm-hmm. So everything around him, he sat back and he looked and he said, this is very good.
Yeah.
Right.
So it wasn't a physical rest. Now, we need sometimes physical rest mm-hmm. on Sabbath, but what Sabbath is really intended for us to do is look around and say, I can rest assured that there's a God who wants to be with me today. Mm-hmm. And that's the rest we join him in, because it was a completed work. And the thing is now we rest in Jesus' completed work, but we also rest in the completed work of creation both. But that's something that's really key about it. God's not simply saying, only go ankle deep in the creek. That's not what this is about. This is about, that's a reference to way further back. But it's something to where he says, rest with me in a completed work. Mm-hmm. And when we enter into that type of rest, it's not stress. Mm-hmm. It's not arbitrary. It's God saying, check this out. Mm-hmm. And I think he did. I think he went around and he goes, you see that tree right there? That's for you. You see the River Tigris over here? That's for you. Mm-hmm. And that was the original Sabbath. That was the template for Sabbaths from Genesis 2 forward. That was the template.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And if, since then, if every human had kept the Sabbath, evolution, the theory of evolution would have never had a chance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in fact, it would never have been thought of.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're resting in God's creation every Sabbath, that just wouldn't be. Also, there wouldn't be any atheists, mm-hmm. right?
True.
Yeah.
You know, or agnostics or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But we let that get away.
Mm. So it's our focus, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, let's Exodus 20.
Yeah, Exodus 20. One thing I wanted to, you know, sometimes people ask, what's the first commandment? Oh, have no other gods before me. But there's a preamble that is so important.
Mm-hmm.
And it's God spoke all these words saying, I'm the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. And God was saying, when they were throwing your baby boys in the river, I delivered you. When the whip was hitting your back, I saved you. When they were going to just completely annihilate and destroy you, I brought you through the water of the Red Sea and delivered you from Pharaoh's hand. Then I fed you. Then I brought water from the, you know, well, he hadn't brought water from the rock at this point yet, but he fed them. He gave them water to drink in the desert. And then he says, if you found me faithful, this is how to love. This is how to respond to me. And that's mm-hmm. the context in which all of the commandments are given. But the fourth commandment, it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. Why? For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Again, this invitation to walk with me in my creation again. Let me show you the relationship I've created you for to enjoy with me. Let me show you what, set aside all the labor, set aside all the worry, come, you know, like human beings are the only people that if their master tells them, you know, or their employer tells them, you know, you got a free day off, you know, that like we're going to be arguing with God, you know,
right.
why can't I work on the Sabbath? Why can't I do what I want to do? It's like, hey, I'm giving you paid vacation here. Come spend it with me. You know, but there we are, ready to, you know, be fighting against it. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. So when we understand this stuff, do you think that, going on to Wednesday's lesson, when we understand this stuff, does the mark of the beast even really matter to us?
Well, I guess in the sense that other people might suffer if they don't understand this, that, yeah,
mm-hmm. right.
then it begins to matter.
But if we can have other people understand it, and we understand all this stuff that we've been talking about, then we say, I don't have to worry about whether I have the mark of the beast. I know there's people, excuse me for bringing it up 3 years ago, but there's people that when the whole vaccine thing happened and everybody was arguing over it, you just got the mark of the beast injected mm. into you. Mm. No, no, no. The mark of the beast is so much deeper than that. The mark of the beast comes to people who don't understand the love and the character of God.
Mm.
It's something that happens very deep here, which is where we have loyalty, morality, ethics, choices. This is where we function as living, reasoning beings in our prefrontal cortex. That's where we function as willful and hopefully good willful human beings. And so the mark of the beast, in short, doesn't really become an issue for us. Why? Because we understand who God is. Mm-hmm. And only those who haven't made God their refuge would receive the mark anyway. But let's read just real quick Revelation. I'm going to read Revelation 12 and 17. We don't have a lot of time, but let's do what we can. Verse 12. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, because he knows that he has a short time. So we understand that he wants to put the mark on those people mm-hmm. realizing he has a short time. He yes. wants to put it there, but God says, I want to give you my seal.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's this play, counterplay, 17, and the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. And so this is so big, because those who get the mark of the beast are the ones who join him in his war. Mm-hmm. If you notice, let's face it, let's call it what it is. Amongst God's people, we have far too many wars.
Yes.
And I'm not calling people, you're representatives of Satan. I'm not saying that, but we have to be so very careful that we don't allow ourselves to represent him and act like we do have the mark of the beast. Mm-hmm. Because if we join him in his warlike tactics, right? Yeah,
right. God works by love, not force, not coercion, not fear.
You know what? For the sake of time, I want to spend the rest of our time, which is just a couple minutes, on the three angels' messages. Mm-hmm. So if we state the three angels' messages, we've already read the first angel's message. If we get the first angel's message right, we understand who we worship, what his character is, why we worship him, and why he's so worthy of our praise and our worship. If we understand that and we get that right, we will proceed to the second angel's message, realizing that we're not calling people, you're in Babylon! No, we're going to show them the love and the character of God, and they're going to go, you know what? I want Babylon to fall.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So then the second angel's message is fulfilled if we get the first angel's message right. And then here's what happens with the third angel's message, which is that warning message. Don't receive the mark of the beast. But I think we've already determined that if, in fact, I understand the law of God, the character of God, then guess what? Yes, Babylon's going to fall, and I'm not going to choose to have the mark of the beast. I'm going to choose to be one of the sealed of God. And so the three angels' messages take on this really good flow. Mm-hmm. And people say, we need to declare that warning message. Mm-hmm. Yes, we do. But even the warning message itself, I get kind of passionate about this, even the warning message itself is bathed in the first one, which is understanding who we worship. Mm-hmm. Because if we go to the third angel's message, but we don't get the first angel's message right, which is there's a loving God who we're supposed to worship, a creator God who fashioned us and maintains us.
And redeemed us.
Yeah, if in fact we understand the first, then the third takes on a loving message saying, please don't get the mark of the beast, because God wants to live with you for eternity.
Right. So my daughter, I'll tell her not to do things. Don't go near the stove when it's hot, when the fire's in there. Don't touch the stove. And she respects it. But she asked me, Daddy, why? What will happen? You know, she wants to understand. And I tell her, if you do this, if you make this choice, this is will be the result. Not because I want to make her afraid, but she wants to understand. Right. And this is what God does. You know, Satan is attacking those who are keeping the commandments of God, because he knows if they do, they'll be saved and they'll find mercy in the judgment. And he's trying to get the whole world to break the commandments of God. And God is just saying, hey, the everlasting gospel of mercy is still available to every single person. And in the light of what I've done for you, fear me and honor me, give glory to me, and worship your creator, the one who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and the springs of water.
Amen.
That's the call.